All right, good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you to Halstrom Academy's webinar series. Today's topic is the harder you work, the luckier you will get. Why grit and determination are important life skills. Facilitating today's webinar, we have representing Halstrom Academy, Ms. Lisa Bernushian, and today's expert speaker, Dr. Kate Truitt. So before we begin, I just want to let you guys know that the webinar is set to conclude at approximately 10:45. We have set aside some time at the end of the webinar for questions and answers. Should you have any questions throughout the webinar, take a look at your go-to webinar control panel. You'll find a questions box where you can type the questions in, and I'll be fielding those questions myself. And we'll do our best to answer your questions. And if for any reason we can't get to your question, we'll be sure to follow up at the email address that you had provided when you registered. Now, before Lisa and Dr. Kate take over, let's get to know you guys just a bit better. Okay. So if you guys would not mind answering this question, which of the following most closely identifies your current role? So you're joining us as what? A clinical professional, an administrator or educator, or a parent? Okay, excellent. Looks like the majority of us are educators, right? But we also have some clinical professionals and parents with us. Welcome, welcome, welcome. And another question for you guys. What do you think is the key to a student's success? And oh, wow, I feel like this is a loaded question. Is this a trick question? Because it looks like there could be more than one answer here. But we're curious to know what you think. Okay, with that being said, I'd like to present to you the facilitators for this evening, Ms. Lisa Bernushian and Dr. Kate Truitt.
Like they knew.
All right, interesting, you guys. I'm looking and we got some mixed results. Definitely some of us think supportive family, some of us think good teachers, some of us are thinking grit and growth mindset. Good guess, definitely a good guess. So it is a bit of a loaded question because really, as parents, educators, and clinicians working with children, we often find ourselves contemplating, what is the key to success? What do we need to be arming our children with to be sure we're sending them out into the world prepared and ready to succeed? So is it good teachers? Is it good grades? Is it a supportive family? It's a little bit of everything. It's all of those components, but really the mindset that you're going into the experience with. And so this morning's topics, oops, I'm so sorry. Hold on one second. I'm so sorry you guys are not seeing my screen. That would help. How about now?
There we go.
All right. Sorry about that, you guys.
Hi, everyone.
Sorry. Hello. Hello. Good morning. We're here. So again, real quick, I wanted to make sure, as we're sending our kids out into the world, it is a little bit of everything, but it's also the way they're entering those challenges, those obstacles, those experiences with that mindset. And I'm really excited this morning to be here with Dr. Kate and to really dive into some of these really important topics. Grit, what is it and why is it important? What has research taught us about grit and determination? How does a growth mindset help develop grit? And what is the best way we can support our kids in developing these key skills? So without further ado, I'm really excited to be here today in Dr. Kate Truitt's office in Pasadena. Kate is a licensed clinical psychologist, and she's been recognized in the Pasadena area for her outstanding patient service. She has really taken a lot of her time and a lot of her studies to dissect the way the brain works and what's triggering those neurons, what's making us, what's wiring us the way we are, and how do we untangle that to really help us achieve our full potential. So again, without further ado, Kate.
Well, thank you so much for having me here today, Lisa. It's a joy, and I've known about the Halstrom Academy for a long time, visited your Pasadena campus, and the work you guys do is amazing. And grit and determination, the growth mindset, is such a important area in all areas of brain development, but particularly when we're looking at working with students and also with our patients in our group. And the idea here is that we have the capacity to actually design and develop how we're going to show up in our life. And I love to start with this quote from Dr. Carol Dweck: the view you adopt for yourself profoundly affects the way you lead your life. And we've had an opportunity to connect this morning a little bit already about how we can show up in our world in a different way. And when it comes to working and teaching our children, you know, so commonly we look at the idea of success being a straight line. And I love this image here, because what it really looks like, as we know, is it's a squiggly mess. And we have this societal construct now that says in order to achieve, we must have skill and it must be innate. And what the literature is showing and what we're going to really be deep diving into today is that, as these equations on the bottom of the slide here show, yes, skill is important. Yes, talent is important. But the only thing listed there twice is effort. And that is fundamentally crucial for achievement.
Yep, absolutely. So let's get into it. What is grit?
What is grit? Exactly. You know, what is grit not?
That's a good place to start.
So grit isn't talent. If we look at some of these amazing athletes that we see on a day-to-day basis, we look at the people we learn about in school, Abraham Lincoln, Eisenhower, we look at Einstein, we think, oh, these are amazingly naturally talented individuals. But the truth is they're actually highly effortful individuals. So grit isn't talent. Grit isn't luck. It's not being in the right place at the right time. And it's certainly not about how deeply, truly you want something in that moment. What grit is actually about is what's listed here on this right side of the slide. It's about persistence. It's about resilience, curiosity, conscientiousness. To go back to Carol Dweck, she talks about that true happiness is about the cultivation of curiosity on a day-to-day basis. And that is what gives us grit. It allows us to be inspired to keep moving forward and drive us even in the face of failure. So grit is perseverance and passion, and a dedication and a vision for the long-term goal.
Absolutely. And there is a lot of research about what it is and what we do with grit. And I'm excited to dive into a lot of that today, because there is a science behind this, you guys. It's not just a theory.
It's not just a theory at all. In fact, Angela Duckworth is the leading researcher in grit. And if you have a moment to check out, she has a great TED Talk. And she starts with one of her most renowned TED Talks by talking about her lack of grit. And I think that's such a testimony to the fact that she has developed grit across her lifespan. And so this, what we're talking about today, isn't just applicable to children, adolescents, and teenagers. It's applicable to us in our day-to-day life. And our brains are trainable, they're learnable, they grow on a day-to-day basis. And so if we look at the idea of grit, it's not about, again, talent or an inherent skill set. It's trainable and it's teachable. We all have the capacity to learn. And talent is about practice and commitment. So when I think about grit, I have a particular patient that comes to mind, a young woman that I worked with some time ago. And she came to my office after her parents found her one day, and she had ripped up her SAT math book. She had broken all the pencils, thrown them across the room, and she was just in a state of agony.
She was done.
She was done. there was no better word for it than done. And she was always a high achiever, very successful young woman, but she had this idea that she simply wasn't capable of doing math. And her whole life, she had committed to not being good at being math. That was part of her mindset. And we'll talk in a minute about the fixed mindset. And so she got stuck in a loop around that. And as soon as we were able to start supporting her and moving into a new way of being present in her work, where she realized that if she had hard work and focus and commitment, and as soon as she became curious and driven about where she was going, not about the numbers on the page, she was able to deep dive into the math and really succeed. And that right there, at the age of 17 years old, took her growing little brain and went from being completely done into a space of perseverance and grit. And it only took a couple short weeks, which is what's amazing about grit, is it's so trainable. So do you have grit?
Absolutely, I have grit. And it's funny, that story really resonates with me. We have so many students at where I work at Halstrom Academy. So many students come into us and they start right off with what they're good at, and then they jump right into what they're not good at.
Yeah.
And it's such a limiting belief, you know, to really start to believe that that's part of your definition. I'm not good at technology. I can't get these slides to work. You know what? I got grit. I'm going to figure it out. I'm going to go back. I'm going to try, and I'm going to make sure that all of those steps I need to do to make sure it's projecting right are being done. And anyone who's ever been in a situation where they really feel like I'm never going to get this, it's such a relief. It's such a positive, completely invigorating experience when you realize I can do that. I actually am quite good at that. And that goes a really long way. Yeah. So how can we develop it? How can we be more like Lisa? How can we be more like that student and really take those obstacles and make it a positive experience that helps us in the future?
Well, what I love about what you just shared there is that idea of we have had successes in our past, and that actually still continues to exist in our mind and our body and the way it feels. And so even you're just referencing, you know, oh, wait, I have done this before. I have achieved this before. And as you noted, what's something that you accomplished that was really hard for you?
Oh, gosh. I'm going to go with driving stick shift.
Okay. I still fixed mindset. I still can't do that yet. And we're going to talk about that yet here in a minute. So driving stick shift.
Yes.
Are you open to sharing your story
about driving stick shift? Oh, absolutely. Because I remember it very clearly. I'm the oldest, and my dad was determined that day to teach me how to drive stick shift. And I don't know if the stick shift was more challenging or my father in the car with me. And at one point, I just had to pull over and say, Dad, I need you to get out of this car.
Wow.
I need you to get out of this car, and I'm going to drive on this street. It was a little dead-end road. There's no traffic. And I said, I'll come back and pick you up in a little bit. And I came back after about 10 minutes of, you know, stalling, restarting. And I picked him up, put him in the car, and it felt so good. And I think it felt really good for him, too, to realize I can do it. And this was a huge accomplishment for me. And I needed to take the pressure off of myself, and I also needed him to take the pressure off of me. So that's the story that instantly comes to mind, driving stick shift with my dad in the car.
And as you're telling that story, do you remember that feeling?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, and the experience of picking him back up and inviting him into your success.
Yes, I was beyond proud. It was, I mean, I'm feeling it now. It just kind of filled me with this pride and accomplishment, and nobody did that for me. I did it myself.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, and that's so key, because our mind and our bodies create memories, and they create memories of both difficult and positive experiences. And so the fact that you can bring that up into your present moment right now is a representation of that. Your body and your mind have encoded that experience of success, and also each small step to support you in achieving that success. And as you mentioned, that start, stop. So you also had many failures along the way, so much so that at one point you said, Dad, you need to step aside. And that idea of failure is such a strong construct in the world we live in today. And it engenders a sense of not being good enough, a deeply rooted sense of a lack of success or not. And with so many of my patients, they walk in there and they go, I'm just stupid. And that young woman who was just done, that was where she was living at that point. She had tried to the point where she was just stupid. Now, in a little bit, I'm going to share her success story. But when she showed up in my office, she was tearful and stupid. And a lot of the work we started doing was looking at, what if every single problem that you are facing in that SAT guidebook is about a first attempt in learning? What if every single mistake was actually an opportunity to challenge your brain to grow?
Right.
soon as we start shifting into the process of growth and success, we now have the opportunity to not only harness the power of neuroscience, but to also start laying down those body memories to tie into that physical experience of success, and also to develop a sense of motivation, enhance our internal resiliency, which ultimately feeds and drives our productivity. So when we're looking at a growth mindset, and I was so excited when you mentioned to me that Halstrom Academy has growth mindset courses and that your curriculum is developed around this idea. And it's really exciting that educational institutions are now bringing this research front and center in how they're working with the children in their space, because it's crucial for success. Once a child knows that they can actually grow their own brain, guess what happens? They want to do it. They love being challenged. And if we take the challenge away from that external space and start to create the sense of I am expanding and growing within myself, they're challenged in new and exciting ways that then creates that purpose that grit requires. My goal is to be stronger in here.
And as I mentioned earlier, so many of our students, when they initially meet with me and come onto our campuses, they really do believe, and it's been there for sometimes years, that they're not good at something. And so going to that curriculum piece and why we've added that into our courses is exactly that. We got to start right there. We got to undo that belief. Mm-hmm. We got to retrain your brain into thinking, I am good at this. I can do this. And if I can't do it yet, then it's something I'm going to keep trying until I get it down.
So, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. And again, going back to research, if you don't believe me, what is research?
Look to the literature. Right. Exactly. And this is such a simple slide, but this really highlights the incredible value of looking at praising the process and supporting children and having a growth mindset. So students were given a two-part problem test in this study that we're showing here. And everybody failed the first problem. It was designed that way. They were given a problem that was beyond their skill set. And within that first failure, half of the students were given praise for being smart. Now, how often do we praise people for being smart? Fairly regularly. I praise my dog for being smart.
We say good job all the time.
Good job, exactly. And yet what this researcher found is that if we praised process, the children then who received the praise in regards to their strategy, their process, how they approached the problem, actually did better. And we see that across the board in every area of life, whether it be somebody who's an executive, whether it be somebody at West Point Academy, where Angela Duckworth has done a significant level of research, or it's in our classrooms. When we start supporting the child and internalizing their capacity, it no longer becomes about the label, because that label can quickly flip from I am smart to I am stupid in the face of a challenge, such as the young woman I mentioned earlier.
Right. Or if you are smart, you run that risk of making a mistake and people thinking, oh, maybe we were wrong about you. Maybe they're not so smart. And if you're smart, you want to stay in that. You want to stay in that happy place. And so that safe zone oftentimes can be quite limiting.
Absolutely. It becomes the structure of if we look at brain development, we actually have neural networks that start to align themselves along these networks of these labels. And so I am a smart woman. I am successful. Well, if I experience a failure in my business, then that means what if I'm not smart? And we can actually then start mind reading and projecting our own fears and failures onto other people and anticipating that they're seeing us in a certain way, which is a lot of what undergirds anxiety.
Absolutely, yep. Our next presentation in April is all about anxiety, and it was so interesting to me, yet again, how much growth mindset ties into even how to cope with and overcome moments where you are anxious or you are stressed. It always kind of circles back to growth mindset. And a lot of the research we're doing right now in education and working with children, growth mindset seems to be falling right in the front of everything. And so it's really a prominent topic.
Absolutely. Well, and when we look at the growth mindset, what we're really talking about is neuroscience. And what we know now is that neurons that fire together wire together. And so is that about firing and wiring the idea of capacity and curiosity and perseverance and resilience? Or is it about firing and wiring together that set scared construct about something? And maybe I'm smart and therefore I can only go so far because I don't want to lose that label. Now, I understand that you taught Spanish quite some time ago, and
yes,
you would see that on a regular basis in your classroom, this fixed versus growth mindset, and how the fixed mindset would paralyze the students and the parents.
Absolutely, absolutely. Teaching high school Spanish for several years, we had a lot of different types of kids. I had a lot of different types of kids in my class. Some came from Spanish-speaking households where they really felt like they didn't need to study. They didn't need to do it. They already understood it. They already knew all they were going to know. They didn't want to know about the accent marks, and they didn't want to know about the vosotros form. They didn't want to know. They knew how to speak it. They were done. No need to continue growing. And then I had the exact opposite. I had the kids who did not come from Spanish-speaking households, who only spoke English, who felt that learning another language was the most daunting task ever. And so
that was me. That was me.
It was a lot of students. And so Spanish was always that class that nobody liked. You know, I don't want to take Spanish. Even if I can speak it, I don't want to take it. And it was really interesting to see how many kids just went into it thinking either they had hit their capacity and there was nothing more to learn, or that they were just never going to learn it. And that's what's so interesting to me about this particular slide. And we have a poster that we have up at our campuses at Halstrom that really does break down what are some things people say when they have a fixed mindset, and what are some things they say when they do have that growth mindset. And it's funny, I've heard these exact phrases being said to teachers, to myself, to peers. And it definitely is something that, as I said before, is just very limiting and paralyzing when it comes to trying to think about how much better you can be.
And one of the things that I want to highlight here is this idea of feedback, because when we're in a fixed mindset, receiving feedback can seem like a threat to self. And that seems like a big statement. But when we look again at the neuroscience and development of self, it's almost as though, hey, how about trying it this way? Then becomes a challenge to, well, don't you think I'm smart? Are you telling me I'm not smart? Or do you not think I'm XYZ? Am I not a good artist because I'm not doing it this way? And when we're sponsoring the development of a growth mindset, feedback becomes an opportunity. It becomes a space for growth.
Right.
And that's something that is really, I mean, as you hear me sharing that, you can hear, well, if feedback is a threat to self, how do we ever, quote unquote, level up, as I talk about it with my patients? How do we get to that next stage where we have the new challenges and opportunities if the idea of feedback shuts us down?
Absolutely. So how do we develop it? What do we do as educators, as parents, as clinicians working with children? How do we help develop that growth mindset?
I love these stickers.
Thank you.
They're totally adorable. And they're amazing statements that we need to share with ourselves and with the people in our lives. And when somebody is endeavoring to accomplish a task, when somebody is moving on a project or beginning a new journey or learning a new skill set, it's, hey, how did that go today? Wow, it sounds like you really challenged yourself. Oh, really strong work as opposed to good job. And I love this. I took a risk today. Each risk is an opportunity. So leaning into those new experiences and sponsoring our children to do the same. Want to create the opportunity for expansiveness and talk about the idea. And I do talk about this when I go out into the communities and work with the schools. How do we learn to walk? Well, we crawl. Well, how do we learn to crawl? We attempt to roll over about 50,000 times and we fail 80% of them. Then once we're finally on our belly and start crawling, we start trying to walk. And guess what? Thank goodness, gravity, we're close to the floor because we fall another 50,000 times.
So, and we have a diaper.
And we have a diaper, yes. And there's the padding. So one of the most fundamental things that we do as humans, just navigating the world, took millions and millions and millions of failures. And so reminding ourselves of that analogy and then looking at how do we frame that for our kiddos, teaching them that failure is so important, focusing on effort and choices and strategies, not saying, hey, good job, you cleaned up. Hey, wow, look, instead of moving into, it looks like you worked really hard on that. Right? Always focusing in on capacity and not skill or talent.
Right. And I love that quote at the bottom, practice makes progress and progress takes practice. It's so true and well phrased, absolutely. And I see growth mindset a lot more in sports and in the way coaches are talking to their athletes. And so practice does make progress. Mm-hmm. It's not practice makes perfect, right? We're never gonna be perfect. There's always gonna be room to be better, to grow. And so a lot of the methods and ways that coaches are working with their athletes, to me, seems to really be hitting the nail on the head in what type of phrases, what type of language,
Absolutely.
What type of feedback should we be giving our
Absolutely.
Students?
Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah. And our children.
And our children.
So even in the home environment.
Right. So let's get scientific.
All right. One of the techniques that we use here in our group is called the havening techniques. And the techniques allow us to harness the power of neurogenesis, and which is generating and developing new neuronal pathways, as well as the power of neuroplasticity, which is one of the fundamental tenets of the growth mindset. It's the idea that we're not stuck in a single way of being. It's the opportunity to help our brain move in new directions, help those neurons fire and wire together in new and exciting ways. And so these fantastic physicians or doctors, one's a physician, one's a dentist, they're twin brothers back in New York City, spent, well, now almost 15 years developing these techniques. And what they realize is these things that we do inherently as human beings have, which is touch, release serotonin and GABA into our system. And through generating additional serotonin and GABA, so serotonin, the antidepressant neurotransmitter, we've all seen the commercials. And GABA is an anti-anxiety chemical in our system that helps us feel calmer. So when we actually increase the generation of that experience in our body, we can help ourselves move through difficulty with greater ease and then move into a space where we're guiding our brain in the right direction. And we teach this to our executives, to our sports set, to our athletes, and to our students, because guess what? We all get frustrated. We all get fearful. We all have anxiety. Those are normal emotions. But when they're strong enough, we know from the literature, it can actually hijack our brain and make us stuck in the emotion, which creates a difficult time thinking our way through it. So I'd like to just take a moment and walk through what this looks like. It's really simple, and it's such an incredible tool for students to have when they start feeling, uh-oh, I can't do it. And get stuck, because remember, we're helping them learn and grow into resiliency and perseverance. Their neurons are still stretching and coming together in exciting ways.
So this is before they rip up the SAT book
yes.
and break all the pencils.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And this was crucial for that young woman's success. So the first step is to simply run. We're going to make little threes on our face. And then down to your arms, like you're giving yourself a nice hug. And then you're just going to wash your hands gently.
This is good.
Yeah. And we're going to do that again. We're going to go across our forehead, around our cheekbones, down, nice hug. And again, wash your hands. And then we just repeat that. And just start to notice how you're feeling doing that simple motion. We're touch-based beings. So touch is inherently soothing. You go, if somebody's having a rough day, do you ever walk up and kind of cup their arm and go, hey, how are you doing today? Yeah, that's exactly why, because this is inherent within us.
And yoga does this. I remember doing this in yoga.
Yeah.
When you start your yoga routine, there's a lot of just let it go, rub your scalp, right?
Yeah, and what we found is these specific areas, the forehead, the cheeks, give yourself that nice hug, and the hands, shifts the electrochemical activity of the brain, which when we look at neurofeedback, individuals who have anxiety, ADHD, and depression, that's one of the things that's causing the disruption, is the electrochemical experience in the brain is not functioning optimally, and this helps rebalance it.
It's like the reset button.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a reset button.
We're hitting the reset button
yeah.
this morning.
And So often when we start to feel anxious, or this young woman who I was working with, I remember she came into my office with her parents, and all she could say is, "I'm just stupid. I'm stupid. I'm stupid. I'm stupid. I'm stupid. I'm stupid." And I don't have anybody. Have you ever done that? I've done that.
In my head.
In your head. And it was heartbreaking. And she was so caught in what we call the amygdala at that point. She was so derailed in that emotional truth of being stupid that she wasn't able to sit down and actually see the numbers for what they were, numbers. And so I invited her to start doing this gentle touch. And then we sang four rounds of Old MacDonald.
Ooh.
Very, very simple. So we sang about cows. We sang about horses. We sang about sheep. Meh. And as we did four rounds, her prefrontal cortex, her logical brain that knew that she had capacity, all of a sudden showed back up. Why is that? Because we're giving her brain a different job rather than looping in that idea of being stupid. And so when she was calm, I asked her to do exactly what we just did with the stick shift. Remember a time when you had a success? She's like, "Oh yeah, that first time I did the verbal SAT, I just rocked it. I almost got it perfect on the test exam." I'm like, "Okay, well, there you go." And then we dialed it back and I said, "Do you remember the first time you took a really hard test and you went in and you're a little nervous, but you really prepared?" And she said, "Oh yeah, I did. I do. I remember what that feels like. And I got the grade back and I was so proud of myself because I did really well and I really earned it." And so I had her do exactly what you just did, Lisa, is remember that feeling while, again, applying this touch, which strengthened the positive feeling. She brought that up, really tuned into the body energy. And then I had her imagine sitting down at to the SAT math exam with that energy. And when she went home and practiced it, she was able to complete all the problems and stay calm.
Anytime, it was like a mental power pose.
It was
for
a
her.
Mental, exactly. It was, yeah, the superwoman, superman, exactly. Beautiful descriptor. And as she started to study then, that we supported her in recognizing when her brain would start to go, "I can't," singing around of Old MacDonald, bringing back up the successes. And then she also started tracking. One of the things that she would do is she would run into a problem she couldn't do, get so frustrated, she started tearing the book up. Right. Now it was about, you know what, even if you run into a problem you can't do, just keep moving through it. And she started, as we mentioned earlier, competing with herself. Okay, this time I'm allowed, I get to miss 17 this time. Change the frame. I get to miss. Next time I get to miss 16. So it wasn't a punishment then, it was, hey, I have these gimmies. So the great thing about this, yeah, with such, I worked with her 4 years ago, and her dad had a vision for her to go to Stanford. She did not, but she did get into another Ivy League school. And she's now studying nanotechnology, and she's going to medical school.
Oh, lots of science and math.
All she does all day is numbers. She found her vision and her purpose. And once she was able to get out of her own way, which is where my team and I really specialize in, is helping the individual's brain stop getting in the way so that they can be their most successful self, then she was able to go live her dream. And she focuses now on growth-oriented process. Each challenge is an area of excitement. And we all have this capacity to generate this inside ourselves.
That's such an awesome story. I'm glad
Isn't
you
it?
Shared that. Yeah, that's great. And one of my favorite just life quotes is, the only person you have to be better than is the person you were yesterday.
Yes.
So if you're growing and you're challenging yourself, that's all that matters. Mm-hmm. That's all that counts.
So true.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
Absolutely.
So lots of stuff, you guys. We shared a lot of stuff. Thank you so much, Dr. Kate. Let's open it up to some questions and comments. Nelson, do you have any good questions that are coming through on your end?
Oh, absolutely. I've got a few questions here. And a reminder to all that you can submit a question just by typing a question in the questions box. So let's start with this first question here. It says here, my child sometimes becomes so frustrated that when things get hard, she wants to quit. How can I help her stay in the game?
I feel like this is my child. I did not submit that question, though. But yes, I'd like to know the answer to that as well.
I feel like that's every child and adult, right? We all hit that point where we're just in that done state. We just want to quit, where things become overwhelming. And that exercise I just walked everybody through is, again, such a powerful, simple way to support our system in moving out of that done, stop, I can't space into at least a space of calm. Because when we're calm, then we can step back and have perspective. Now, obviously, sometimes our children are going to look us a little sideways. We go, hey, honey, can you just do this? Right? And so it's also, again, moving into the space of process. And they're so frustrated, it's supporting them and recognizing that they're working really hard. It's using that languaging to be engaged in what's going on in that moment, validating them, honoring them, connecting with them in those moments, and letting them know that you see them and that it's okay to take a break. So often, especially in this competition-driven world that we live in, our children don't realize that it's okay to take a break. And so supporting them and knowing that, and there's a lot of great literature on the idea of failure. So bringing the language of failure into the house, that you're, it's okay to be frustrated. That's a healthy emotion. Remember, if you fail at this, it's just an opportunity to help your brain get bigger and stronger.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. All right. I have another question here. It's related to growth mindset. Okay. Now, do you feel that older children have an easier time developing a growth mindset, or is it easier for the younger children? As a matter of fact, I'm going to add to that. What about us grownups? Where do we fit into this whole growth mindset scheme? You know,
what's the expression? You can't teach an old dog new tricks. Is that true when it comes to growth mindset?
It's not true. You can teach an old dog all sorts of tricks. I have one. It's amazing. I was just reading a research paper the other day about a study that studied infants and toddlers and the way their mothers interacted with them on process-oriented praise versus success-oriented praise. And they did a 5-year follow-up. And the infants and toddlers that 5 years later, so now they're in preschool, first grade, received process-oriented praise, had a growth mindset, and were more open and receptive to feedback and being present, and were more driven to stay when the task got hard. So that can say, like, oh no, but, well, what if I wasn't raised that way? I know my parents certainly had a achievement-oriented mindset, and yet I have a ton of grit. They kind of did a 50-50 on us. So we can learn grit across the lifespan. It's really about, a crucial part is changing the way we talk to the people in the world around us and the way we talk to ourselves. I was working with middle-aged lady, about my age, I guess I'm middle-aged now, just yesterday, and we were talking about how an old pattern of being consistently gets in her way and causes her to significantly avoid specific situations. And we started reframing those situations as, okay, that feeling of avoidance, of procrastination, I don't want to. What if we called that a data point? And what if when that data point shows up and you notice that energy, or you start pulling back and turning away to do something else that you don't need to necessarily be doing in that moment, became an opportunity for you to ask yourself, how can I grow here? What's the exciting challenge in this moment? How will this help me get to the next step? And our brain loves questions across the lifespan. So anytime we query a question, our brain will start showing up and going, well, what if we did that? That was going to feel better. And so the more we ask ourselves those process-oriented questions, no matter what the age, the more our brain is going to start to wire and fire. Remember, neurons that fire together, wire together in that process-oriented direction, creating more opportunities to grow and expand and be gritty.
All right, Dr. K, we got some very interesting questions coming in. Okay, I'm gonna, I got a couple of more good ones for you. All right.
We've done all of our practice.
We're ready, we're calm, we're zen.
So, good, yes, do your havening thing. Okay, doctor, you mentioned you mentioned that when a student envisioned a test, they had been successful in the past, right? Envisioning that test, they were successful in the past. But what happens if they have not been successful? What are you saying then?
Yeah. Well, I'm asking if they've had any success. And it doesn't necessarily have to be a school-oriented success. What I love so much about the growth mindset is we're focusing on process. So it's not specific to a single topic. It's, wow, you did really strong work while you did X, Y, Z, or wow, look how capable you are at sitting down and strategizing. Well, you can be capable of strategizing how to build a Lego playset as you can at finishing a math problem. And so it's looking for experiences where they have moved into a space that they consider a win. And that can be anything across the board. So it might be, remember that one time when you slayed that dragon? Okay. I want you to, let's go back to that experience and how that felt. And, or that, remember that fort you built in the living room? How amazing that was and how cool it was. And we all got to sleep under what you created. Wow. Look at that. Let's remember how that felt when we were all sleeping in that pillow fort together.
And I love the way Carol Dweck talks about it in her book, that power of not yet.
Uh-huh.
So I know with my kids, it's always telling them not yet is still progress. Not yet is forward motion.
Yes.
And feeling that there's always a next day and a next try and a next attempt and you're just not there yet, I know that works really well for my children.
Absolutely.
In making sure that they're not just stuck on, well, I worked so hard and I still got a C.
Yeah.
You know, well, you're not a B yet. You're not an A yet. But, you know, you put a lot into that. And I love the way you really made flashcards this time. I love the way you're trying to figure out how do you learn best. I love the way you asked a lot of questions going into it, trying to really identify what's going to be that thing that gets me to really, get this concept.
Yeah.
And those are all big wins right
absolutely.
There.
And the gradients. So frequently we lose sight of whether it's a failure or a success, and we miss that each step is a moment for growth, as you're mentioning, Lisa. And supporting ourselves and our children and tracking those little gradients. So I had a pianist who was applying to go to Interlochen, which is a fantastic music school. And of course she chose a huge overture as her performance piece. And she kept stumbling over one piece of the overture. And so her teacher reached out to me and asked for some support. And how do we get her to the next place? Because she's going into that done space where I fear, she's like, she's going to come down here. She's going to cut the chords on the piano. That's where she's at now. And we talked about, well, what if it was getting to, again, to the end of the piece and allowing yourself X amount of mistakes and then reviewing, hey, you stumbled over here, but this time this was great. And even though you stumbled, you kept cadence and pace, or even though you stumbled, your staccatos were still amazing, which before they were a little sluggish. My mother's a concert pianist, so.
I was like, wow, you know a lot about piano.
And bringing in all those tiny nuances for the gradients of progress. That's what we're looking for. Because each moment of practice, remember, practice and progress and practice is leading towards the ultimate success and the vision and the goal. So that's a really important piece. And that's the yet. So you can't play the entire overture perfectly yet, which to get into Interlochen, you need to. But look at how far you've come just today.
Okay, I guess we've got time for one more question. And I know, Lisa, you made reference to a book by Carol Dweck. Those of you that are not familiar with the book's name is Mindset. But here's a couple of questions came in on this very topic, very near and dear to my heart, technology, right?
Wow.
So what about the students that are overindulging technology, those wired kids? How do you get through to those kids?
Well, I'm not quite sure. What do you mean? As though I can hypothesize that perhaps the question is looking at our children who are kind of deep diving into the tech and perhaps not showing up and engaging in the world in the way the parents or the teachers would find preferable. That's my hypothesis.
That seems to be the way the question is leaning. It's almost like they're so overindulged. They're so involved in technology, right? Where they're shutting themselves out to the rest of the world. So how do we address those students?
Yeah. Well, and I think that sounds also like something that you'll be addressing in the webinar next week, is looking at what is going on for those children that A, they're so immersed in this space that they're not showing up in the rest of their world. One of the things that I do see in my practice is that children will frequently, again, immerse themselves in the world of tech because that is where they get those small successes. If we look at World of Warcraft, if we look at the, I can't remember what it's called right now, but so many of the games create the opportunities for the small successive gains that a student might not be receiving in their day-to-day life. And so it's about translating the opportunity for successes and achieving and helping them connect to the fact that they have capacity in the real world such that they want to participate in the real world. And frequently we get those little dopamine bumps in the video games, and that's why they actually hire cognitive neuroscientists to help design those games so that people become addicted to them, and that's a very real thing. So it's a very complicated question, Nelson, but one of the things I do know and what the literature certainly supports is that we will go where we feel good. And so if we're not getting the progressive successes, if we're not feeling capable and like we have capacity in the real world, we're going to go find some place that we do feel that way, or we'll numb out from it, which then leads into substance use and many other conversations.
All right. And I guess in the interest of time, just to clarify to the folks out there, we are recording this webinar, and we will be following up with you and sending you a copy of this webinar as well. I'm not sure, Lisa, if the slides will be available to them as well, but somebody had asked about that.
We will send the slides and the recording out to you guys. Thank you for registering. Yep.
All right. So, so folks, if you're interested in learning a little bit more about Halstrom Academy and our growth mindset course, feel free to contact Lisa at lisa@futures.edu, especially if you want to learn extra shift sticking skills. You know what I'm saying? You want to learn how to drive that shift stick? Lisa's your.
I like that.
I might kick you out of the car, but yeah.
But she'll invite you back.
Right.
And a special thank you to Dr. Kate. In addition to her being a master at the havening techniques, Dr. Kate and her team, they specialize in harnessing the power of brain science to support their patients and live in their excellence. She's worked with individuals from ages 11 on up. And her team's expertise will obviously empower you and your family to be gritty. There's no question about that.
Thank you,
Nelson. Special thanks to Lisa and Dr. Kate.
All right. Thank you, Nelson. Thank you so much for operating all the controls for us. And
yes.
A big thank you again to Dr. Kate for being our guest this morning and for all of you for joining us. We will be sending out the recording. Also following this, you will receive a very, very brief survey. I promise it's short. We'd love to get your feedback on that. And again, thank you. I hope you guys enjoy your day.
Yeah, thank you so much for inviting me to join you today. It's been such a joy to share about these topics that are so near and dear to my heart. Please reach out if you have additional questions. I also have a Facebook page, Dr. Kate Truitt, where I post several times a week new opportunities about how to engage your brain in new and exciting ways. And I found a fantastic video this morning about with a young group of children and a fantastic group of teachers who do a rendition of This Is My Fight song, but it's This Is My Grit song.
Yes.
So check it out.
It was
good. Posting that later today. It's adorable and a really great way to solidify everything we've talked about today.
All right.
And folks, you may be wondering, this thing could possibly not get any better. But if you're interested in the topic of stress and anxiety, make sure you tune in next month for April's webinar. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Dr. Kate.
Thank you.
Enjoy the rest of your morning.
You've ever been a lady to begin with. Luck be a lady tonight. Luck let a gentleman see.